The meeting next week, we'll start, the registration will start at 2:30. Arnold would like a short meeting with the finance committee, and I think I've already talked to all of the committee, all three of us. We're going to have a short meeting at the results. Just a reminder that on the 27th, there will be a proposed budget set for next year. There will be reports needed from each of the boards and committees. And I can't think of anything else.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. Now, think about it. Isn't it just like God to have a cool temperature today when we're going to be eating hot soup? God is a good God. Would you stand with me, please, as we say the pledges? I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word, a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Its words shall I write in my heart, that I might not sin against God. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood, uniting all Christians in service and in love. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you.
you find it, if you would stand, please. Lord, we do thank you for your greatness, your faithfulness to your word, your promises of deliverance from Satan and his henchmen. So, Lord, as we continue to ask for your protection from the evil, may we always find in your word the hope that you offer to each and every one that is willing to surrender their lives to you. I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now as we open our hearts and minds, we've got our Bibles open. Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your strength. Hear my prayer, O God, give ear to the words of my mouth. For strangers have risen up against me, and oppressors have sought after my life. They have not set God before them. Behold, God is my helper. The Lord is with those who uphold my life. He will repay my enemies for their evil. Cut them off in your truth. I will freely sacrifice to you. I will praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For he has delivered me out of all troubles, and my eye has seen his desire upon my enemies. Now we're going to ask Steve King from the Gideons. Steve's been here before, probably, I don't know, 40, 50 years ago, Steve.
Oh, at least.
Oh, I love the sense of humor.
All right. See what this sense of
Well, you think I could get started sooner? All right. A Gideon named Peter Bogart was participating in a sidewalk distribution at a middle school in Gresham, Oregon. We do sidewalk distributions at middle schools because we can't go on school property. We have to stay on public sidewalks. As a young student approached him, Peter started a conversation and asked him, "Would you like a free New Testament?" "No thanks. You gave me one last year," the boy said. "What did you do with it?" Peter asked. "I took it home, threw it on the coffee table in our front room because I didn't want it. My dad came home, picked it up, he leafed through it, and eventually read the whole thing. He got to the back and gave his life to Jesus. Just in case you don't know, there in the back of our New Testaments is what I call a plan of salvation. Scriptures can lead someone to Christ. Then he gave it to my mother. She read the whole New Testament and trusted Christ for salvation. They said I should read it, and I did. I got to the back and prayed to receive Christ as my Savior. My sister also got saved. We all attend church together. I just thought you would want to know how God used that New Testament to change our family. Thanks for giving it to me last year," the boy said. "One testament changed the lives of an entire family. As a born-again child of God, how much effort does it take to start a conversation, offer a New Testament, and share the good news of Jesus Christ?" The Gideon Ministry was started in September 14, 1899, 125 years ago, just about a week ago, when two Christian salesmen met for a Bible study in a hotel. And no, I wasn't one of them. Okay, Dave? All right. Today, the Gideons are composed of nearly 150,000 business and professional men and their wives worldwide. There are Gideons in over 200 countries. We provide scriptures in over 100 languages. Our focus is on winning people to Jesus Christ. We do that through association together, personal testimony and personal word, scripture placement and distributions. Gideons are business and professional men that are men of God, men of faith, men of action. But as believers, We should be men and women of God, men and women of faith, and men and women of action. We distribute scriptures in the traffic lanes of life, at schools, prisons, hospitals, doctor's offices. Recently, our auxiliary, our wives, handed out over 100 New Testaments in doctor's offices in LaPorte and Michigan City. We also go to hotels and motels. Gideons have distributed Bibles, put them in the hotels in Michigan City and LaPorte recently. And if you ever go to a hotel, first thing you do is look in the drawer or look on the bureau and see if there's a Gideon Bible there. We also go to military personnel, firemen, and police officers. Between 50 and 90 million scriptures are distributed worldwide by Gideon's International every year. This summer, we distributed 1,300 New Testaments at the LaPorte County Fair. Some of you might even have been there, might even have gotten one from us from our booth. Also, at the Blueberry Festival, did anybody go to the Blueberry Festival of Plymouth? If you did, there were 6,500 New Testaments distributed from our 10 by 10 foot booth there by Gideon's from other camps, other counties than ourselves. Also, 870 New Testaments were distributed to Amish schools in and around Shipshawana last Thursday morning. The Gideon's International had their state convention in Shipshawana. The Gideon's went out and distributed to the Amish schools on that Thursday morning. And then also recently, about a month and a half ago, one church in LaPorte delivered 118 meals on iHeart LaPorte on a Saturday. They cooked 118 meals, and we took them to 3 fire stations, 2 hospital emergency rooms, the EMS station, 911 call center, police department, sheriff's department, and each meal also had a friend of Gideon's New Testament. These are testaments that anybody can buy. They can register to be a friend of Gideon's. They can order the New Testaments, and as a church body, they can use them for Awana, for VBS, or anything they want to. And we'll have them downstairs also after church for Super Sunday. But you can buy these yourself and distribute them to yourself just like that other church did. Every Gideon New Testament is designed to help simplify the sharing of God's Word. For example, on about page 3 of the New Testament, there are helps, as you can see up there, and it has the helps. It's an alphabetical list of life's challenges, like if you're anxious, afraid, depressed. It tells you to turn to page 10 or 11, depending on which New Testament that you have, and it says there, as soon as I can find it, I thought I had it marked, but I didn't have it marked here. But anyway, it tells you not to be anxious for nothing and to focus on God. And then in the back, it also has what I call God's GPS, God's plan of salvation. It tells you right there on this page, and every New Testament has this, God loves you, and it has John 3:16 right there, and you can read it. And then it says, all are sinners, and it says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one, Romans 3:10. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. So it gives you the scripture verse right in your hands to share with someone. It's a remarkable little tool to have. God's remedy for sin. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 6:23. It also has 1 Corinthians 15:3-4 and Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and it's not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. And then it has your response. So you can lead someone right through God's word right here. Your response, then it has Romans 10:9, it has Revelations 3:20, and it has receiving Christ. So it's a tremendous tool to have at your disposal. You don't have to be a scholar to show this and have someone read this. How many of you been to Culver's? Anybody been to Culver's? Hey, we got 3 people, 4 people, all right. One Sunday after church, Sue and I took our daughter, son-in-law, and 2 grandkids to lunch at Culver's. We ordered, sat down, and shortly a teenage boy brought out our order to our table. Jacob, my 12-year-old grandson at the time. My 12-year-old grandson had seen me offer a New Testament numerous times when we've been out to eat, etc., and showed the helps and the plan of salvation to a waiter or waitress. I said, "You're up," and I handed him a testament. I didn't coach him ahead of time, I just handed him the testament. And there he is. He stood up in Culver's. That's me on the right. That's him with his back to us. And he's sharing the same thing I just shared with you, the helps in the front and the plan of salvation with the young man in the middle of Culver's. There's no age restriction to share God's word. You just have to step out on faith. We're going to watch a short video right now. And it's a witnessing testimony. It's really kind of cool.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life.
If you have heard these words before, you're one of the 6 out of 10 people in the world who have heard this good news. It's a hard truth, but recent research shows that just over 40% of those living in our world today are still categorized as unreached people when it comes to hearing the gospel of Christ. To those of us who know him well, that number may seem shocking. Jesus seems so near and accessible to us, but studies also show that only 5 of every 100 Christians around the world actually share their faith with others. That means most Christians accept this good news for themselves and forget that not everyone has yet heard.
How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching?
Think about what Jesus called his disciples. It wasn't pushy or judgmental. He wasn't prideful in his parables. In fact, his invitations to follow him were just that, invitations. Jesus met people where they were, which is good news for us, because that means we can meet people as he would, anywhere. Being a witness oftentimes begins before you speak, because your actions are a testimony of your faith. Be in a spirit of prayer while talking to someone about Jesus. After all, to the unsaved, the gospel is a mystery.
It's a mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to the saints, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory.
Ask him to guide your words and open a person's heart to hear his truth.
Pray in all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication, that words may be given to me in all in my mouth, boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel.
As a member, you already have a great tool to answer any questions. Just remember, it was never your job to play Redeemer, so you don't have to pop the question every time you share your faith. Sometimes being a witness means planting seeds and trusting God for the harvest. The Apostle Paul wrote,
I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth.
Your role is to simply be obedient to how God prompts you.
And he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation.
If you haven't heard that one before, you've surely heard it now. What will you do today to share Jesus with the people God puts in your path?
In 2019, my wife and I were in Ireland over St. Patrick's Day.
On a company trip, I don't know why I'm getting ready to cry, but I usually cry during a presentation, and I just don't know why right now, but anyway. After breakfast on Sunday, I think I'm thinking about my 12-year-old grandson, Sharon, in the middle of Culver's.
In Ireland, on Sunday, we left the hotel, went for a walk. We soon came across an old, small brick Methodist church. It was 10:50 in the morning, and church started at 11 o'clock. So we went in, and sanctuary was about 25 by 40 feet, so it was roughly about the size of your whole podium up here. It was about the size of the church. There's about 30 people there, including children. People were friendly, and I noticed a couple of people had a Gideon New Testament in addition to their Bible. Sitting on their Bibles in the pews was Gideon New Testaments. After the service, I asked one man where he got the New Testament. He said the Sunday school teacher gave it to him. So we went into the adjoining room after the service to meet him.
He said that he shares God's word through Gideon and Testament with everyone he can. I'm reminding you, this was 5 years ago. He pulled an orange New Testament out of his pocket. He said he had since the mid-1980s, about 35 years prior. That is actually a picture of the New Testament, the actual picture of the New Testament you're looking at right there. We're going to see some pictures, but you might notice that my wife has gloves on holding that. That's how full it was in that church. All right, go ahead. The cover is worn on it, and Sue was holding it with a gloved hand, like I said. Inside the cover, there were names of students and scripture verses in John, Luke, and Matthew, possibly names of kids that had been he'd led to Christ. One page had scripture verses, Luke 10, 18, 19, Matthew 4, Matthew 5, 13 to 16, Romans 12, Proverbs 3, 12. The two back pages has God's plan of salvation and scripture notes. Two blank pages there in the back has scripture thoughts. Get your thoughts away from yourself. Reach out for someone else who needs more. Look beyond yourself to help others. What we think we become, practice positive thinking. Moods are determined by your thoughts. The family is the basic unit of the church. And then a picture of a young man. The man of God, man of faith, the man of action, who was a Sunday school teacher. He was willing to share God's word with the Gideon New Testament for over 35 years. There's no age restriction, like I said, when Jacob was offering the New Testament in the pulpit. There's no age restriction to share God's word. You just have to step out of faith. And it was very coincidental, I say that with a little pun, very coincidental that we just happened to leave the hotel and find that church right there, right before they started. It was very coincidental that there were Gideon New Testaments on people's Bibles. Very coincidental the man that distributed them for over 35 years was there that morning. He just happened to have that New Testament with him that he carried. What an encouragement from God. Isaiah 55:11 says, "So is my word that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." He was a born-again believer, he stepped out on faith, and he shared God's word to a dying world. Is there anything stopping myself or anyone else from doing that? Absolutely not. We just step out on faith. You can join as a friend of Gideon's, and like I mentioned, you can buy your own New Testaments to use yourself. The Gideon Ministry is a missionary extension of your church. You're a vital part of the Gideons and a powerful tool in the hand of God. Without your support, we can't do this. First, you can help by supporting us in prayer. You can pray for scripture distributions and personal witnessing. Secondly, you can also use our Gideon Expression Card Ministry, and you have a rack of cards out there at the front entrance. There's three kinds of cards. There's in memory when someone passes away. There's thinking of you. You can send for any occasion. And there's on your special day, such as a birthday, anniversary, graduation, etc. And I noticed there's a couple of birthdays in your bulletin, so someone may want to grab one of these cards. And you can write whatever you want to in the cards. There's also a place where you can determine, you can write how many Bibles you're buying in honor of that person. Bibles are $5 each. Buy 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, however many you want. Send the money to the Gideons, give the card to the person. It's very, very, I encourage you to use that. It's very neat to do that. Thirdly, one of the easiest ways, like I mentioned, is to join the Friends of Gideon. We have brochures out there. It's free to join the Friends of Gideon's. It costs you nothing, obviously, but you can buy, once again, you can buy the New Testaments that you then personally can use or individually or as a church, if you so choose. Also, if you're a qualified business or professional man, we want you to prayerfully consider joining our local Gideon camp. We found that Gideon men become better spiritual leaders in their homes and work in their churches and their communities. All of you can help financially today by giving to purchase Bibles and New Testaments. Testaments cost about $2 each now, and Bibles about $5 each. As God leads, please give them your expendable money. That's the extra money we spend on things like fast food, Walmart, World Game. Think about it. Give to change lives. Give to save souls. We want you to be there. Be willing to be used by God. I'll be at the back after the service. If you want to give today, I'll have an open Bible. You can just give there. We'll also stop by the display table, take a friend's opinion brochure, and I'll be downstairs eating soup later. Thank you for allowing me to share what God is doing in the Gideon ministry. Now you can go back up.
All right.
Thank you.
Twice.
I've known Steve for a number of years, and always appreciated his presentations as he comes up to the churches to represent the Gideons and the work that they're doing. It's, you look at the number of Bibles that are handed out by him, there's an effective ministry there. As he said, you don't have to browbeat people. Saving people from God's job. As Steve said, we plant seeds. And I reminded people when I talked to them about their salvation that I'm not perfect, but that I'm not the same man I was 30, 40 years ago, even 5 years ago. Does have a change in one's life. Amen. Praise and prayer time.
We got a call this morning just before 8 o'clock, and our sister-in-law in Indianapolis said to me, well, your brother and your sister are having a conversation. 17 years ago, about the same time of the year, our sister, who was 15 years younger than me, passed away on Sunday morning unexpectedly. So I knew my brother was with the Lord. We got a call this past week from his wife, and she said he'd been put on hospice, mostly Alzheimer's but some other complications, and they said there's nothing we can do for him. So the family's strong faith and prayer was that just the Lord would let him go soon, which he did. But two sweet things I want to share. He hadn't been able to initiate a conversation for a long time. Sometimes he could comment a little. This past week, he hadn't talked at all. But one day, he sang, "Jesus Loves Me." And 7 weeks ago, I think, to this very day, he and his wife had come to LaPorte. She was in Rogers and my graduating class. We had a final reunion. My brother hadn't gone because he wouldn't have recognized me. But they stopped at our house the next day on their way home to Indianapolis. I had made a lemon meringue pie, which I know the Lord had a hand in, because the filling set up like it should, and the meringue had a trunk. And my brother and his wife both ate 2 pieces. And it was so sweet. He all but licked the design off the plate. It just did my heart good. And before they left, I hugged him and I said, "I love you." And he said, "I love you too." So I have that beautiful memory. And our family is strong and in faith. And while we're sad, we're rejoicing to know he's with Jesus.
Dave?
Where are you at? Well, you're blending in with the pew.
I just want to thank everyone who is involved in whatever way you've been involved with the Super Sunday. It takes a lot of people to put something like this together, and I appreciate everyone that has helped out, made cookies, made soup, whatever. And the kids, my teen class, was already down there helping this morning, and they're going to be working also during the soup meal anyway. But thank you to everybody who's participated. I appreciate your help.
Thank you, Betty, for being us on.
Well, I have a prayer request for me. Wednesday, I'm going to take the nuclear stress test and the echocardiogram that I messed up on earlier in the month, drinking coffee before I went in. But I do have that, and did meet with the electrician of the heart last week, and I think it was last week, it might have been the week before last. And there's a possibility I may not need a pacemaker, I may need a pacemaker. Hearts slow down sometimes to 43 beats a minute. Or a minute. So anyhow, if the stress test and the echocardiogram look good, or if they might, if they could suggest maybe they need to do angioplasty to see if I've got arteries blocked, that can be fixed without the pacemaker being put in. So just ask for your prayers on Wednesdays as I go in and hope the results are favorable. Any others? I just think, Steve, as I set up here, that sometimes we miss opportunities to share God's word with people. And sometimes salvation comes and we're too late to answer.
I've got one other phrase that I didn't mention. I don't think I did, correct me if I'm wrong. But last Thursday, and I mentioned at Kessler Middle School, we distributed 85 New Testaments to kids that left the school. The first time we've done it in probably 10 years, I think. But out of about 120 kids that walked out of the front of the school because everybody else gets on buses and gets in the cars with their parents, etc., we handed out 85 New Testaments to kids that were coming out on the 18th Street in about 15 minutes. Get out at 2:35, at 2:50, the buses, the cars, and all the kids are gone. So 15 minutes, 85 New Testaments, what the answer to Jesus at Kessler.
Pastor Josh.
I trust wherever you are today, you might hear these words of David, who prayed in the midst of a time where he was being pursued by Saul. Day by day, there wasn't a night that he put his head down to rest and wondering if this could be it, if Saul would find him. In the midst of strangers, in the midst of a town, they send word back to Saul, and David hears about it, worried that he is slowly losing an opportunity to find places to rest outside of Saul's presence. But he prays to the Lord that the Lord might save him from the hands of Saul and his men. But he makes this proclamation in the middle. Surely it is the Lord our God who is our help. It is the Lord who chooses to sustain us. And as we gather this morning, may the Lord sustain you. May you know that truth, that the Lord sustains you. That he created you, he sustains you. And in sadness, he also calls us and says it's time for our bodies to give up. They age, they don't last forever, but he is still with us and he is still near us. And so let's go to the one who has drawn near to us that we might be able to draw near and say, surely he is our help. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this morning as we are gathered here today, we celebrate you as one who has been our help and who is our help in the world today. Lord, we know that life doesn't promise us all great things. It doesn't mean that we will not have troubling or difficult experiences. But we do know that you are near your creation, that you do not sit far off, but you came at a very distinct moment by sending your Son to be one of us, that you might demonstrate the extent of your love, that would hang on a cross, that would be buried in a grave, but would be raised by your hand. To tell the world that you have their life in mind. And that life does not just begin after our death, but it begins now when we see you and we know you and we acknowledge that you are near. Lord, we cry that in the presence of your Spirit, you would be near to us today, just as Jesus was near his disciples. That we would know that you are close enough to call upon you in the midst of the circumstances of our lives, the good and the bad, the easy and the troubling, the ones full of joy and the ones full of sorrow. That you are always near us. Your grace, your mercy, and your love are always before us. And for that we give thanks. Lord, thank you for this day that you have made. We rejoice and we are glad in it. We are glad for the sound of rain on the rooftop. We are glad for the crops that have been planted, have grown, and now are in need of harvest. We thank you for the ways that you have provided in our lives, and we thank you for the sweet stories that even in the midst of our sorrow and grief, we can say, because those around us knew you, even though we are departed in this world, yet we will see and talk and celebrate again with each other in your presence before your holy throne. Lord, lift us up today. Lift us up in the weight of our anxiety, our trouble, our grief, our sorrow, that we may celebrate and sing of your goodness every day of our life, that we may offer our goodness to you, that others may know the story that you are a God of life and you are a God of goodness. Work in us today, we pray. For we give our lives to be your people and ask that you would be our God. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. And if you're able, let's take a moment to stand and give God thanks for the things he's given us. At the back and at the front of the sanctuary, if you have not done so, is an opportunity for you to give of a tithe, a gift, or an offering to the Lord, that his ministry through Mill Creek might continue.
Praise God from whom
thanks be to you for the gifts and the things that you have provided to us. Receive what we have returned to you, that it may bless others with your love, your grace, your mercy, and your forgiveness. We pray all these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. You may be seated. Let us hear the words from James, where he writes, "Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. For such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, and comes from the adversary. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his words.
Good morning again.
Morning.
Sure, and neither one have sang any solos for a very long time. She's kind of lost her singing voice due to COVID, and I'm just plain old. But anyway, we lost our mom 3 years ago in August. Mom was a singer. She sang when she peeled the potatoes. She sang when she swept the kitchen floor. Tomorrow, our mom will be celebrating her 97th birthday in heaven. And this song we're going to sing is an old, old song that Mom loved and surely had recorded it, and we did have it played at her funeral. But in honor of our mom's birthday, we're going to sing it today. Don't expect anything special, and don't listen for harmonies because we're both sopranos, okay? And the pianist on our CD is our own Sue Smith. She recorded it for us several years ago, I think, and we're just now getting around to singing it. So I hope you enjoy the song. It's called "Will There Be Any Stars in My Crown?"
I am thinking today of that beautiful land I shall reach when the sun goeth down. When through wonderful grace by the Savior I stand, will there be any stars in my crown? Will there be any stars in my crown?
because we sing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, and it is on page 575 in your handbook.
Took the opportunity to breathe on them And in the Gospel of John, it tells us that he says, receive my Spirit. Receive my Holy Spirit. The gift of the Spirit given. Really, the gift of the Spirit that began the early church, that swept through in a variety of ways, and Luke tells us about that in the book of Acts. And how, even when the world around them tried to silence the voice of Jesus and his followers, and they were scattered to different parts of the world, God began to use those small pockets of people. Those people who were faithful to proclaim what God was doing in the midst of them, of how the Spirit came upon them and emboldened them to pave the way for Peter and the apostles to come through and to proclaim the good news of Jesus and what he has done. That God, through Jesus, sent his Son into the world to walk with us, that we would know, one, that God is near us. That the number two, the extent to which God would go to demonstrate how expansive his love, his grace, and his mercy is to those who receive him. What's interesting about the stories of Jesus quite often is sometimes words were used, but oftentimes it was Jesus drawing near others in the moment of their need, providing them healing, having a conversation with them, providing them the food and the drink, providing them his presence. Today we get to hear a conversation that Mark records, and that, let's be honest, is recorded in other Gospels as well, with other, sometimes other details. But it's a conversation that Jesus has with his disciples about his death and his resurrection, but also what happens and transpires after that. That Mark records to us that he says that they all had left that place and passed through Galilee. And Jesus did not want anyone to know where they were because he was teaching his disciples. In other words, Jesus wanted a moment with those that closely drew unto him. This moment was not designed for the broader world. Jesus wasn't ready to reveal this yet to a broader group of people. But yet he said unto the smaller group of disciples that the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill him, and after 3 days he will rise again. And then it said that the disciples did not understand what he meant. And they were afraid to ask him about it. I wonder sometimes what kind of teacher Jesus must have been, that he sometimes instilled fear in even his closest disciples. That they didn't want to ask him. They didn't want to admit where they were, that they didn't understand what he was talking about. What do you mean that you will be killed and then on 3 days you will rise again? And so they came to a place in Capernaum. And when he was in the house, Jesus asked them, what were you arguing about on the road here? But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was going to be the greatest. So here it is, Jesus revealing to them that he wasn't going to be with them forever. And just when we think, well, what would a good disciple do? A good disciple, they would be carrying this weight. What do? We not only don't understand it, but Jesus just revealed to us that someone's going to kill him. Someone's going to take him out of this world. Someone is going to assassinate him. And just when they were all with that weight, they began to have conversation. Wait, if Jesus is going to leave us, who's going to continue on with his ministry? Who's going to continue to take care of these people that have come to follow him? And so it raised a question. Jesus realized that at some point on the road, they just weren't conversing about it, they were arguing about it. It was dividing them. It was causing conflict in the midst of it. And so he asked them, "What? Tell me about what you were arguing about." And of course, once again, in shame, they hang their heads because they knew that they were talking about something they shouldn't have been talking about. They realized maybe at that moment that they were arguing about something that should not have even come up. That they were diverted from what Jesus was wanting them to see. So they kept quiet. But of course, in other Gospels, we know that Jesus already knew what they were talking about. Jesus says it. He already knew. Gospel records that. And so he sat down with the 12. And he says, "Let me be honest with you. If anyone wants to be first, they must be last. And a servant to whomever they come in contact." And then he took a little child and he had him stand among them. Taking them in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one of these little children in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me does not welcome me alone, but the one who sent me." I don't think that there's much that needs to be said to understand what Jesus is saying. That Jesus, in a real way, says, in this pivotal moment where Jesus pours out his heart to his disciples, says, "Hey, I want to let you in on what God is doing." How often do we pray to God, "God, let me know, where are you? What are you doing? What does this mean?" And as we're praying, something in us diverts us from actually listening to God. An anxiety in us, a trouble in our lives, the weight of the kind of news Jesus is telling us, the things Jesus is asking of us, something diverts us. And our attention goes to some other different conversation. At this point, it was who would be the greatest? Who was going to be in charge when Jesus left? Who was best equipped to be in charge when Jesus left? So often in our lives, we're diverted. And so Jesus points out that danger. That Jesus points out that sometimes we pray to him, we pray to God, we ask for things, and then we stop listening. The danger in our faith is that we are often in places where we request things from God, but we do not listen to his voice. We do not listen for his response. And rightfully so that day. It's because it was too weighty for them. It's too much. And so Jesus comes in and he says, "Tell me, what are you talking about? Sister Carol, why are you not listening?" And then he very clearly points to his disciples and say, "Let me tell you what the kingdom of God looks like. Because let me be honest, the question of who will be the greatest, that's a question that comes from the world. That's a question of what makes you most successful in this life? What makes you feel powerful in this world? What is the ladder that you have climbed in order to get to where you are and think that you are something? The world has one answer and God has another. You want to be great in the kingdom of God? You want to be among the great people of faith? You must remember what He has called you to be. All the way back into the Old Testament when He said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord, He is one." And we are called to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our strength, and with all of our minds. And when Jesus was asked the question, "What is the greatest commandment?" Jesus said to love the Lord your God. And the teacher of the law commended him, and Jesus said to love your neighbor as yourself. You want to learn the secret to being greatest in the kingdom of God? It's very simple. Jesus provides not only the danger of diversion of what happened, it's easy for us to get diverted, but He provides the criteria. Jesus says, to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, you must become less. And you must become servant. A Jesus who later on would come and, when He was invited to a dinner, He would take out His outer robe, He would put a towel around His waist, and He would wash the disciples' feet like He was serving them, as He was their servant, to demonstrate to them that the priority in the kingdom of God is service. To love God and to love our neighbor. And then Jesus, as in case they would not get that, He provides an object lesson. And He pulls a little child, I don't know how old, an old enough that Jesus could pick the child up and hold them. So my guess is, let's just call them a toddler. In the midst of their terrible twos, in the midst of the most cantankerous moment when they're all trying to do something and they're running around like crazy with all the energy they can, playing their games, trying to distract from the event of the evening, Jesus calls the child over, picks the child up, and says, "You must be like a child to understand the kingdom of heaven." What Jesus did in that moment, we in our world, we value children. We spur them on to goodness. We try to spur them on to greatness, to make certain choices so that one day they might grow up and live independently. But in this culture, a little child was nothing but the property of their father. They really didn't have any intrinsic value. Sons, yes. Daughters, no. Daughters cost money. So He takes the little child. I wonder if it was a little girl. And see this child who is nothing but property. See this daughter that brings no value to your family heritage. You must become like this child. You must become nothing. Why would Jesus ask that? I know, through the life of Jesus and what He has done, He understood how easy it is to become tethered. He understood that danger for us to become tethered to the way that the world defines success. But more importantly, what Jesus wanted from them is to realize that whoever could welcome the least of the world would learn to welcome Jesus and would learn to welcome his Father. In other words, Jesus was giving us a practical example of what it meant to be called to love your neighbor. Not a neighbor who can give you something back. A neighbor, even the neighbor who can't give anything to you. Not just the neighbor who can scratch your back because you scratched theirs, but a neighbor who is unable to provide you anything in return for the service and the gift that you provide them. When you understand that a child, a small child, is so needy, they need your attention that no matter what you pour into their life, you may never see a return on your investment. If you're okay with that, and you can receive that child, then you have learned to receive me. And you have learned to receive my heart. I want you to be people who don't choose the way the world is successful, defines success. But if God places you in a position of great success in the world, that you will choose to bless others in the same way, in the same manner. That you will use what God gives you to bless others around you. Not because they are able to give back, but because what you are giving them is the very grace and mercy and love of Jesus Christ, whom you call. Learn to put a towel. Learn to put a towel around your waist. And you will find the secret to the kingdom of God. This is one of those passages that, I'll be honest, as a preacher, it'd be a whole lot easier if we could just cut that right out. We could just skip over this passage. I don't like it when Jesus points out the dangers of my choices. But I do appreciate that when Jesus points out the danger, he provides the criteria. And he gives us an example of what it means to care for the least of the world. Because there are people out there that are needy, that have needs, who are praying to God, relieve me from this situation. Take these things away from me. Release me. And God might just be saying they need someone to come alongside of them and to walk with them as I have walked. But when you do it, don't do it because they can give you something back. Do it because you recognize that God has given to you and in return has asked you to do what he did to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, what he did for David, what he did for Solomon, what he did for Ruth, what he did for Esther, what he did for Jesus, what he did for Peter, what he did for Paul. What he did for everyone that he called, regardless of who they were before he called them. Who said, when he identified that, I give you my grace and mercy, not because you deserve it, but because I want to give it, and I want you to be utilized as my blessing to someone in the world. But you, as my chosen people, must stop being diverted by the conversations of how great you are and how great and faithful God is. That it is not us, but it is He who does the work. I don't know personally any of these people that Steve had talked about this morning. I've never met them. But so many of them would say, I have absolutely no idea. I had no idea that God would work in this person's life in this way. You do not know. But yet they were faithful to say, let me hand to you what I know about the love and grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ. May we be those people that say, even if we get no return on our investment, yet the things that are given today is so someone out there may know the grace, the mercy, the love, and the forgiveness of Jesus. May we be those people. Heavenly Father, breathe on us, breath of God. For we need to be filled with life in it. Because our desire is to love as you love, and to do as you have done. Lord, anoint us today to serve those around us, and when necessary, to use words. We pray all these things in your precious and holy name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. And for those of you that are guests, I often remind the congregation that your amen is really representative of the words, and may it be so, which is a recognition that we hear and a recognition that, yes, I am willing to become that. I am willing to be sent by God into the community around me to be that love, that grace, and that mercy. We always receive in order to be sent by God. So let us, as we prepare to go and break bread together, let us choose to be sent, to be a servant of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let's stand and sing as we prepare. And I'm going to change things up a little bit. We're going to sing that first verse of Breathe on Me, Breath of God again. We're changing the last hymn on you, Sue. 393 in your hymn. Spirit, till we are gathered again to celebrate what He has done. Go in His grace and mercy. Amen.